the song we sing in our church. How many have at least one thing to be thankful for? If so, put your hands together. He did it all. Scripture reading this morning is going to be coming from 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 1 through 9. By the righteousness of our God and Savior, Jesus Christ. Grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. Seeing that his divine power has granted to us everything pertaining to life and godliness, through the true knowledge of him who called us by his own glory and excellence. For by these he granted to us his precious and magnificent promises, so that by them you may become partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world by lust. Now for this very reason also, apply all diligence in your faith, supply moral excellence, in your moral excellence knowledge, and in your knowledge, self-control. And in your self-control, perseverance. And in your perseverance, godliness. And in your godliness, brotherly kindness. And in your brotherly kindness, love. For if these qualities are yours, and you are increasing, they render you neither useless nor unfruitful in the true knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. For he who lacks these qualities is blind or short-sighted, having forgotten his purification from his former sins. May God add a blessing and a reading to his word and to the hearers.
Bless the Bible and word in prayer. Father in heaven, we come once again this morning on this way in Ohio. Come, Lord, thank you for this another brand new day we never have sought before. Thank you, Lord, that we've laid down, slept and slumbered the last evening, that you've watched over us all night long. We just want to say thank you. I want to give you all the praise and the glory this morning. Again, allowing us to see another day that we never had saw before. Thank you for giving us a mind to come to your house of worship this morning, to serve you in spirit and in truth. We ask you, Lord, just walk through this place, Lord. Someone may need a touch. Someone need an encouraging word. And then, Lord, there, they don't know which way to go, Lord. We ask you to just touch them to give them, Lord, a peace of mind, Lord. Let them know that you are there for them, Lord. We just thank you this morning. And then, Lord, we ask you to just give the pastor word from heaven today, Lord. Bless our choir today with sing Zion song, that musician, Lord. Just bless his fingers, Lord, that they can play the Zion songs, Lord. Whatever you have for us this morning, we'll be careful to give you all the praise and the glory, Lord. We just bless our government, Lord, the soldiers that are fighting over another country, Lord. Bless their home, their children, Lord, all their beings, Lord. We just thank you for all that. And then, Lord, we ask you to bless the bereaved, the sick, those that have pain racking in their body, Lord. We ask you to just bless them. We just thank you this morning. Then, Lord, when we've done all we can do, we can't do anymore. We ask you to give us a home in our king, for we can ever praise thy name. Name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
First of all, I'm going to do this a little different. I'm going to ask all the birthdays to please stand for the month of June.
So snow, you always tell her, be careful what you ask for. Because all the way down there, I said, boy, I said, oh, wish I could go home and rest a little bit, you know. You know what, I ended up getting that too. I didn't have a pro, you know. But anyway, we gonna try to go to be with them today. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. And how y'all feel?
All right. All right.
Amen. Amen. That's good then. That's really good. Let me say this and make sure that we keep on coming to Sunday school and Bible studies and teachers is teaching. And did I tell you about Robert Robinson? Okay, yeah, Robert Robinson. Texas man, he got a toothache. He got a bad toothache. He's been working with that toothache for about 2 or 3 weeks. Amen. And so we want to make sure that we pray for him and pray that he get that toothache or whatever they have to do on. And I believe it was Brother Newton and Neil, Brother Neil and Brother Robinson, Brother Robinson, they was up here yesterday and they was cleaning the church, you know, got all the grass out of the flower beds and on the side, so we thank God. Let's give them some praise. Amen. Going higher to service, we'll tie our tithes and offering. And remember, God loves a cheerful giver. Amen.
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 Thank you.
congregation. I don't know about you all, but I need to pray. Upon us.
us. When people walking into schools and shooting up and killing folks, have mercy upon us. And then God, I pray that you just touch each and every one of us, put your arms around us, and help us in the name of Jesus. Oh God, 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 we ask that you would just have mercy upon the sick. Be with them because they need you, because their strength is getting a little weak. Have mercy upon us. And then God, we pray that you just bless us. I want to ask you again, just bless us, this church, to have the love that we're supposed to have for one another. Bless us, God, to have forgiveness that we're supposed to have for one another. Because we come to you when we sin, God, and you have mercy upon us. So bless us to be able to have a forgiving spirit. God, we thank you. And then, God, as we go into your word today, I pray in the name of Jesus that you will bless your word, strip me of myself, and bless your word that it will come forth and come with power and conviction, that someone will hear your word and come crying, what must I do to be saved? And then we pray, God, that something from your word will lift someone up today, because we get weak sometimes. Sometimes, God, the devil gets at us. So we ask that you would just have mercy upon us in the name of Jesus. God, we thank you. And then, God, we love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And thank you, God. Thank you. same Lord, the ninth chapter, verses 33 through 35. There is a word that comes from the Lord.
Refuse to control.
we refuse to constrain, that bottle we refuse to put down, that language we refuse to clean up, that gossip we have that we still have refused to repeat, the trouble we should have steered clear of. Oh, but I come to tell you everything that we do, everything that we think, everything that's in our heart, Jesus knows all about it. Are you with me, church? Now, in our text today, Jesus and his disciples have just arrived at Capernaum. And they no sooner got settled. And then that's when Jesus said, what were you guys arguing about while we were on the road? That's in verse 33. Now, it's hard to believe anyone would turn armor about anything in the presence of Jesus. Are you with me? Yeah. You see, some things in our life we just ought to put on the back burner and not Jesus. But when Jesus is in the presence, I come to tell you, we ought not armor about certain things. Because if some people come in God's house and they have armaments on their mind, if you have armaments on your mind, you can't praise God with all of that stuff on the inside of you. But I guess that, Brother Hillson, human nature has a way of developing even in holy environment. Are you with me? You know what I mean. Keon Hillson, he says, what the enemy sends after you show you what's on the inside of you.
Yeah.
Did we catch that?
Uh-huh.
It shows you what's on the inside of you. So you can be trying to be living a holy life, but he knows what's on the inside of you.
And he'll send it right to you.
Uh-huh. Are you with me, church?
Uh-huh.
You see, let me see if I can help. That unkind words or remarks that we sometimes make at choir practice.
All right.
That unkind remarks that we make sometimes at usher practice. That unkind words that we make in deacon's meeting. That judgmental attitude towards a new member. That criticism that we do sometimes at our business meeting. And most of the time, we catch ourselves, but sometimes things just slip out. Are y'all with me, church?
All right.
So I guess we should give these disciples the benefit of the doubt and say that they were just caught up. Caught off guard by the overwhelming temptation before them. And what was the temptation, preacher? I'm glad you asked. It was the temptation to be the greatest disciple. I said this in a message before. These disciples were having a moment or Muhammad Ali moment. In other words, was it Peter, who Jesus had called the rock? Was it John, who loved Jesus more than anyone else? Was it Luke, who offered free physician service? Was it Matthew, who had connection to the Roman Treasury Department? Was it Mark, who had an ear with the Jews? And was it Judas, who held the purse strings? So, as soon to their destination. Verse 34 says that Jesus asked them a question.
Yes. Mm-hmm. All right.
What were you guys arguing about?
Yeah.
Why you were on the road? Uh-huh. And the disciples, they clammed up. In other words, they held their peace.
Right.
The brief account of this gives us an insight into the mindset of the disciples and the mindset of Jesus at the stage of their walk with their new rabbi. The record is short, and it tells us three things. First of all, disciples had not yet developed a strong faith. Let me say that again. The disciples had not yet developed a strong faith. These young men were still under the protection of Jesus. They were servants in waiting, operating under their limited understanding of this new gospel. They were new babies. Their faith was not yet developed enough to empower them to do the work of the ministry. So in other words, these schoolyard disciples were essential basic training. They had no diplomas had been given. No orders had come down to them. They were not yet licensed to perform the work of the kingdom building. And all of the special servant residency was being performed under the license of the Rabbi Jesus. And at least some of these disciples must have wondered, how did Jesus know about the armament that they had on this road? After all, they thought that they were being unnoticeable and terrible. They thought that they had taken every precaution not to be within earshot of their master. Otherwise, they would have tangled their armament and then waited till Jesus went to lay down, and then what happened then that they would go to sleep. You see, it wouldn't be long before the disciples got a real life lesson on the work of ministry. When Peter, James, and John came down from the Mount of Transfiguration, and John, the other disciple, a man came to them with a proud request for his lunatic son, who he said sore vexed. And that's in Matthew 17 and 15. So he told Jesus that he brought his son to these disciples for them to cure him. But they could not cure him. Jesus quoted them for their weakness, calling them a faithless and perverse generation. And then what he did is, Jesus did, he rebuked the devil, and the Bible said that the child was cured in that same hour. So the disciples came to their teacher and said, why could we do that? Jesus said, I don't want you to get your bread and get your Bibles. Jesus said, it's your unbelief that is your stumbling block. Oh, I wonder, how many times have we prayed? How many times have you prayed and then believed in what you were praying for? Are you with me, church? You see, listen to what Jesus said. If we listen to what Jesus said, this will take us a mighty long way. You see, it takes prayer and it takes fasting to develop your faith before you get to the performing miracles. Now, I want you to turn your Bible to Matthew 17. Turn your Bible to Matthew. We ain't gonna be long. 17, look at verse 20. When we look at verse 20, I want you to look at this. Look at this real close. And it said, and Jesus said unto thee. Y'all see that? Watch this in the next verse. Because of your unbelief. For verily I say unto you, if ye have faith as a grain of mustard seed, ye shall say unto this mountain, remove hence to yonder place, and it shall remove. And nothing shall be impossible unto you. And then the next verse said, howbeit this kind goeth not out by prayer and fasting. Notice that word he said, because of your unbelief. I know I'm paraphrasing this when I say this here, but Jesus made it clear. He said, faith is the key. You see, it's the substance of the things all we hope for. What the disciples were lacking, Jesus said was faith the size of a mustard seed.
Yeah.
Let me put it this way. Everybody is not going to have the same faith.
Amen.
Are you with me, church?
Amen.
Somebody's faith ain't going to be strong as others. And when your faith don't be strong as it should be, that's what he said, what he's talking about as the size of a mustard seed.
Yeah.
To them, it may have sounded insulting because somebody start telling you you ain't got enough faith. It might insult you. The mustard seed was the tiniest of seed. Surely that they had at least that much faith. If you love it and you do it, at least you got that much faith. Right. So were they following Jesus? Were they trying to do what Jesus said? But to understand this, we need to understand how the mustard seed grows.
Yeah.
Right.
It might be the tiniest of seeds, the size of a penny. But by the time it breaks through the ground,
right,
the stump has already developed a root system that will sustain it through the drops that it's going to have.
Uh-huh.
Watch this. Jesus was comparing the growth of a mustard seed with the spiritual growth of his disciples. They needed to develop a deep root system of faith to prepare for the things that they was going to have to go through.
Right.
The storms that they were going to have to go through.
Right.
To defy the devils. Uh-huh. Then second, we learned that their desires to be the greatest was not godly.
Well,
they knew this. And sometimes we know it too.
Uh-huh.
Are you with me, church?
Yeah.
These disciples had to know this, and you know it too sometimes. When we see it and we mess up, we know we are not where we need to be.
Amen.
The reason why I say this here, because the Bible tells us, it makes it so clear if you sit back and read it. It said they held their peace.
Yeah.
When Jesus asked them, what were they arguing about? At the moment Jesus posed this question, the disciples was ashamed of their argument. Have you ever did something you know you was ashamed of doing it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You said something in your life, you know that you should have said it. But you said, somebody told me one time, Pastor, you were cussing one time. And then after I found out I was doing it, I was ashamed of it. And in our lives, see, when we sin, God allows us and he shows you one way or the other where you messed up.
Yes,
and I ain't
going to
say messed up, I'm going to say sin. Mm-hmm. So in other words, what I'm saying, it's ridiculous to think that Jesus had a faith. can use it. If God give you a voice to sing Zion's song, then use it. See, they was trying to find out who was the greatest, and Jesus already knew. Every disciple, and this is what I'm saying, if he give us a talent to be an usher, then be an usher.
All right.
Peter had to enter the holy body of Christ in Jerusalem.
Yeah.
John will be the ultimately write the book of Revelation on the Isle of Patmos. Thomas will spread the gospel into the southern India. James, the son of Zebedee, and James, the son of Alphaeus, will both preach to the early converts in Rome. Philip would preach to the Greeks and the Syrians. Nathaniel would preach to the Muslim in the northern kingdom. Matthew would preach throughout Ethiopia. And Simon the Canaanite, he would preach in Egypt and Africa and Britain and Persia. And it was only one that would betray him, and that was Judas. So every disciple, just like each and every one of us have a purpose.
Yeah.
And we ought to use what God gives us. You see, these disciples try to avoid the question. And that's what we do sometimes.
Yeah.
We always want to bring up what somebody else is doing rather than what we're doing.
Amen.
And so we learn here that Jesus knew all about it. And our text said that he sat down and called his 12.
Yes, he did.
And he said unto them,
If any man,
I believe this is what Brother Cecil read, if any man desires to be first, the same shall be last of all and the servant of all. When Jesus said this, it was right there that Jesus put an end to their debate with one sinner's life list. If you want to be first, he said, be last. Right. Don't seek to lead, but rather seek to serve. Right. In other words, he said, lead from the rear. Our human nature, it gets in the way of genuine Christian service.
Yes, it does.
In other words, it responds to flattery. It motivated by power and prestige. So in contrast, Christian service is a selfless and often without earthly rewards. It does not seek to be the front runner or trailblazer. True Christian service does not seek to manage or spread or spearhead the spread of the gospel, but to do it one saved soul at a time. And if a Christian is chosen to lead, it is by virtue of his community.
Right.
Leadership sought in other way is not what Christian leadership ought to be. And I think that I close now. And I used to hear the choir sing. Or I heard them singing that serving the Lord would pay off after a while. Am I right about it? And every now and then you hear him begin to say that he may not come when you want him to. But he's always on time. Am I right about it? And sometimes I used to hear the old saints begin to say, trouble may come your way, but trouble won't last always. Am I right about it? And we're living in a hard time right now. Can I get a witness up? But we learn how to trust in the Lord. I found out that he'll make a way out of no way. Am I right about it? And I know you've been working a long time for the Lord. Can I get a witness? But I come to tell you this morning on the way to heaven that Jesus, he knows all about it. Am I right about it? He knows about your purpose. Can I get a witness this morning? And that's why he said, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Am I right about it? That's why I said Jesus knows all about it. He knows about your financial contradictions. Am I right about it? That's why he said, wherefore God so clothed the grass of the fields, which today is and tomorrow is cast into the oven, shall be not much more clothed you, O ye of little faith. Am I right about it? That's why I come to tell you that Jesus knows all about it. Am I right about it? He knows your fears. Am I right about it? That's why he said, fear not them which kill the body, but are not able to kill the soul. Am I right about it? Jesus, he knows all about it. Can I get a witness? He knows about your sorrow. That's why he says your sorrow shall be turned into joy. Am I right about it? But Jesus knows. He knows all about it. He knows about your persecution. Am I right about it? That's why he said, every idle word that men shall speak, that shall give account thereof on the day of judgment. Am I right about it? I've got to get out of here. But Jesus, he knows all about it. Am I right about it? And he knows all your ups and downs. Am I right about it? He knows, church, your good times, and he knows your bad times. Am I right about it? And he knows what you've been through all the rest of the 6 days that passed by. Am I right about it? And he knows the trouble you've been through. Am I right about it? Jesus knows all the aches and the pains you have in your body. Am I right about it? Jesus knows. He knows when you lose a little one. Am I right about it? Jesus knows. He really knows what we're going through of the world that we live in. Am I right about it? But what I'm trying to tell us, we need to hold on to God's unchanging hands, and everything gonna be all right. Am I right about it? Anybody here that knows Jesus, he will take care of you. Am I right about it? If you know Jesus, I'll take care of you. You ought to wave your hand up in the air and tell somebody he's all right. Ain't he all right? Ain't he all right? I tried him. I know, church, he's all right. Won't he walk with you? Won't he talk with you? Am I right about it? Won't he stop by and wipe the tears from your weeping eyes? You ought to tell somebody, ain't he all right? Ain't he all right?
Amen.
Did you seems like the heat is hitting me right up in here. And you watch my nose will start running. It seems like it's a heat that's popping right on top of my head. So pray for me. Amen.
Amen.
The doors of the church stands open. Jesus did it
over 2,000 years ago.
I'm gonna try to talk to Reverend Robinson and make it the deacons, whoever we can talk to Brother Robson and see if we can, what we need to do to help him. Because most of the time when you got a tooth problem and that tooth is bothering you for 2 or 3 or 4 weeks, then you really need to get that tooth out of there. Uh-huh. And then perhaps it's probably, maybe you don't have, I get too much into somebody's business, but maybe you don't have insurance to get that out of there. I jump up and say, sometimes I say stuff I probably shouldn't, but I'm old school. And I just see it the way I see it, you know. And so if you need to kind of help me, maybe we can help you in some kind of way, or go to the doctor. I get you in a lot of pocket, you know, to help him go to the dentist, amen, to try to get that tooth removed, amen. Did that sound all right to you all?
Amen.
So we'll work on that. We'll work on that.
Yes. Now, so we have our moms called. There is a clinic here, Wellness Center, off of 80. They have a dentist and they go right in.
We'll have them call you, amen. We'll have them call you. I will call him as soon as we get out of church, and I call him and I let him know to call you, amen. See, that's what you get when you ask, amen. Right. When Reverend Robinson comes to come to church, you know something wrong with him. And then the kids, and he was up here yesterday working out there. Probably shouldn't even be doing that, but he was out there. Amen. Amen. Is that it?
Thank you so much. We've given it to God. And y'all want me to go a little bit longer?
And I'm saying this here because I like to try to let everybody know what I'm doing. Lots of times when I lay down at night, and when I lay down at night, for some reason, I start sleeping with my mouth open late, and I start snoring a little bit, and my throat gets so sore that when I get up in the morning time, it starts trying to Jesus' name, amen, and thank you, God.